Ladies and gentlemen, good morning, and a very warm welcome here to the Reinvention Laboratory once again. This is already our second day here, and well, thanks for joining us this morning already. I hope you've had a wonderful opening ceremony last night with that impressing floating stage, which I myself had really never seen before, and I'm almost sure many of you haven't either. Here in this Reinvention Laboratory, we will not have a floating stage, but we hope to get some ideas in the air later and have vivid discussions again this morning, which we had already yesterday. And, well, we have a full day ahead. Those of you who haven't seen me yet yesterday, I am Corinna Egura. Am I still on? No? Do you hear me? Yes. Sorry. I'm Corinna Egra. I'm your host throughout this entire week in the Reinvention Lab. And yeah, we'll have some very exciting and interesting discussions together, I think. Well, let's get started. A full day ahead of us. Our topic now is cultural engagement and affiliate development in the IEC. In an international working environment like the IEC, where experts from 90, almost 100 countries come together and share their knowledge with each other, different ways of working and thinking. Of course, they were largely in an efforts made towards the common set of standards. So in this session, we'll first take a look at culture, how it has fundamentally influenced work in our technical groups and how we can turn it in favor when we encounter obstacles caused by cultural differences. So, ladies and gentlemen, I now have the pleasure to introduce to you our first speaker. It is Peter Fischer, who is from IESA, which is a company that is in the cable industry quality management in Switzerland. And as a member of several technical committees, he is focused on data cables and test methods. Peter, the floor is yours. Welcome, and we look forward to your speech.
Thank you, Corinna. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to my presentation. I hope you had a good party yesterday. Welcome back to the Reinvention Lab. I want to put some ideas on the stage here, and this is not a normal presentation. I need your feedback, I need your ideas, because we don't have the solution yet. And what we are actually looking for is we need ideas from other people in IEC how they solved similar situation. So, the title of the presentation or the discussion we have now is Clash of Culture. So, what we have in our committee, in our technical committee, we are mainly dominated by Western countries, but more and more new members are joining, new countries are joining, and they also want to contribute, and they have somehow different ideas about what standardization should be. So I will explain you a bit our case, where we stand at the moment. And then, finally, it's your turn to come up with your experience, with your ideas. And I hope we have a discussion between different people, different solution, and explaining why some solution works or some don't work at all. So then we will just write down your ideas. And this idea I will take with me, and I will share with my colleagues in our technical committee. So, what I'm looking for, we need to be creative. We have to come up with new ideas. This is very important because the problems we are discussing are new. So, we need new ways of doing, new way how to create standards. So we have to think outside of the box. That means we are normally just meeting and have always the same meetings in the same style. So what can we change for the future? And then, of course, it's important to have all the different solutions together. So we have finally choices of what we could do. So I just took a few slides from the IEC slide desk. And what is a standard? So experts join, and they are representing different countries, stakeholders, and they sit together and discuss. So it's a kind of consensus finding between different point of view, different cultures, different background. It's always voluntary, of course. Consensus, one of the keywords here for this presentation, what it means. So we have somehow to discuss and find a solution, a way how to go forward most people can support. But consensus is never unanimity. So it's not that all have the same point of view also at the end. But most opinions are in the documents. So, to illustrate a bit the differences between different cultures, I found a very short movie, which is putting on some points which we probably already know. And I just want to show you this. So that means Western people go straight to the solution. Eastern people, they found somehow a way. Who is talking with whom? What is defined as beauty? And how is the perception of each other? The relation to kids and animals. And for standardization, also very important how we handle problems. If you go to a restaurant, you see this. It's loud. Point of view, how important I am for everything about the weather. We normally say rain is bad weather. It's probably wrong. Rain is also needed. Party, how was the party yesterday? Then how we see each other. Punctuality is an important point. We are normally exact time. This you have probably also seen. Queuing is very different. Then if we have some health problems, we have different solutions. Sunday, on the road, in Western countries, very few people are on the road. How we see our boss, how we see our structure in the company, but also in the family. And about food, meals. I think it stopped. Okay. Good, that was only to show some points. Of course, it's never complete and somehow also not correct. So it's depending on people, but in one point, it's just showing that there are differences. And these differences we have also in standardization. We have different point of views. So in our case, what I want to present is just the current stage. We have three documents. They are at CD stage now. Actually, these three proposals came from China, and they were supported. So seven countries said yes, voted yes. When we had the meeting, most of the countries had a lot of opposition. They were somehow against, or they wanted to change a lot. So we agreed to circulate the document in the committee, and now just on Friday we had the comment resolution. So we don't know where it's going on, and actually what is the point of discussion. So Chinese, they say, we need detailed specification. I think everybody agrees on that. They specify parameters, electrical, mechanical, and so on, requirements. But also, this should help to increase the quality and have an easy kind of trade between different countries. So on one side, we have the cable, and the cable is somehow connected to a connector, and this has to fit. So if we define the cables in details, we know that it will fit together well. So it has also an influence on the users, finally. They can just go to the specification and choose the cables they need. We reduce the number of variants, so we don't have thousands of different cables. We have only a few. And finally, we create one large market, which of course is a great opportunity and is also finally reducing the cost. On the Western side, people say, okay, it's good to have this specification, but there are too many details. Everything is defined, so I have no freedom. I cannot slightly change my cable. I cannot improve it. It's everything is defined, is blocked. So normally the Western companies are more discussing with their customers about how the cable should look like and what the specific solution and the setup, how the cable is made, should look like. Generally, the requirements we have are quite low, so they are not in the high-end sector. And sometimes there are some conflicts with regional standards, especially here in Europe. We have separate standards for some kind of these cables. So I come back to this point. How shall we solve this situation? So we have different point of views, what a standard should be, what should be in the standard and what should not be in the standard because it's too restrictive. So what I ask you now is, do you have some similar experience in your committees? Had you such discussion before? Was there an exchange between different opinions? What was the solution? Did you find a way to integrate the different opinions and somehow improve the standardization work that everybody saw himself reflected in the final standard, in the outcome, in the product, that everybody could go home and say, yes, we did good work, we did something everybody can agree with. I can give you some example of what I've heard from others already. One opinion is that we probably don't write standards for the very specific parts. So we shift more to a technical specification, which is less binding. That could be one way. Or we could say, yeah, we reduce the amount of points we discuss. We put as fixed in the standard to have some kind of compromise. So that could be one way. Of course, it's a bit more binding than only a technical report, but could be helpful to further develop the standardization work. I don't know if someone is here who has another opinion or another idea how we can finally solve that, or what kind of documents we can create, or how we should work together, even at the beginning, probably before we write the NP, that we write the NP together. But several people already discussed it before. If someone has some experience in that, I think this kind of discussion is in every technical committee, but probably some they already solved that, or probably they did not solve it, just happened, and then a real clash between the different cultures happened. So my point is just, how can we agree on a way together to find solutions for most members which can be supported? So I don't know if we can just note down these points. And if someone has other opinion, of course, you're invited to present your way, how you have solved in your committee such kind of discussion, conflicts. It's about solving conflicts, and what I'm sure is we see it now with more countries from the East. Sooner or later we will have more countries also from other parts of the world. So we will have more from Africa, we will have more from South America, I hope, because this is the idea of the affiliate program. And so we will have more opinions, and somehow in the future we have to define or find a way, probably not for all committees the same, to find a solution for such, at the beginning, disagreement and discussion we have between different point of views. Yes, please.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me introduce, I am Fernando Gomez from Uruguay, South America. We are part of the affiliate program. And perhaps it's a different point of view. Standards is about confidence. And we need to be confident in the committees. So I don't think it's a problem of culture. It's just something that all the human beings we are. We must make confidence and be sure and go ahead with the committees. From our perspective from South America, we are more users of the standards. We are not makers of the standards, because we don't have, at least in our country, in my country, such industry in the electrotechnical field that make us to give opinions. But we are users, and we need the standard for protect us from products from abroad. So what is needed is some kind of participation for clarification of some requirements that are in the standards. During the maintenance periods of the standard, there are any possibility to ask or to clarify this. And it's my opinion, IEC should think in something, a tool for clarification of requirements, not be so thinking in making standards, new standards. The standards that really are now are very important, and it would be important to have some kind of feedback from the technical committees. This is my opinion. Yesterday I was at the TC23B and I saw this kind of thing. People from Spain helped me a lot with a lot of questions I have on existing standards. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That's for my part. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I think it's important that we have a certain base we can discuss with each other. We find for everybody what he needs in the standard. I think that's very important. And what I've learned is that Eastern countries, especially China, they did exactly the same. A few years back, they just attended the meetings. They listened, they found out, oh, it's working like this. Okay, I can bring in my idea. And after a few years, they said, yeah, now I have an idea. I want to write a standard. And I think that's the next step. And sooner or later, that will happen also from other countries. And then if you will write a standard, you will write it differently because you need other details, other information in the standard that you can finally decide, okay, this is good with this paper, I can go home and I can produce something according to standard, and exactly, I feel confident about that. And different countries, they need different information in the standard to come to this confidence level. And this is somehow the challenge we are in that. Yeah. Yes, please.
I think we have to step back from the cultural side to really distinguishing between what a standard is, what is a specification is. And I think even in the engineering community, professionals, there is still a lot of confusion between standard and specification. And I have seen that in technical committees. People keep arguing, no, this is the value to be put in there. No, this is a standard, so it has to encompass a general thing. Whereas the specification includes all the design requirements and other things for the purpose of procurement and the manufacturing and whatnot. So I think that distinction should be made really clear by the standards body, then probably it would accommodate the cultural differences, the way they view the standard versus specification. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah, we have some more opinions, yeah?
Yes.
Please.
My name is Rosario Uria. I am the affiliate leader and I came from Peru.
Okay.
My intervention is about how the country, developing countries, must improve their participation in the standardization. I think it depends of the country, depends of the grade of developed the country. If the country has priorities, they must prepare the people to participate actively. This is the idea. So it depends of the country. The country must set up strategies, prepare the people in all issues, in the issues that is priorities of the country. And we need to support the countries to improve their participation. And the developed countries must to support the developing countries in this objective.
Yeah,
Thank you. I think the comment I'd make is, if we exclude for a moment the cultural issue of East versus West, just in Western standards, typically what happens is that the largest companies dominate the committee. And obviously for commercial, they have more resources and commercial interests to make that happen. So when you bring in other cultures, essentially, you might say new cultures see it as a way of, you know, attacking a new market, as it were. So assuming we'll never get consensus, which is, I think is the case, we can concentrate on areas of mutual agreement, which are, you know, safety, interoperability, and perhaps reliability. Because that helps the ultimate customers who don't have those resources to make decisions on how they treat the standard. Because otherwise, someone says, I'm totally compliant to IEC, blah, 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 and the unaware customer says, oh, this must be a good product. So if the committees reflect their priority, which is, you know, the safety, reliability, then it gives the flexibility to producers to come up with better products. So I think, assuming you'll never get consensus, which I think you we have to accept, you have to then focus on those which you can agree on, which is safety and those, the issues I mentioned. So you have to be able to plug it in, and it has to be safe. Then the consumer can decide which path to proceed.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So hello, I'm Jens Greiko from DKI. So when following the discussion, maybe I can derive a proposal how to proceed. What is today's situation? We start in the first meeting of a working group or project team, we start basically with a whole Word document. And we try to shape this document during the next meetings and the stages of CD, CDV, and so on. But maybe we need something like a modular approach, where we say, for example, in the next session we will hear about the use cases, which is more easy to understand. And maybe this is for the user perspective important to say, okay, we participate in shaping just the use cases. Later on, we go to the detailed specification of test requirements. But this is maybe not of relevance for like the affiliate countries. But of course, for different manufacturers and also for manufacturer of test systems, it's very important to have the test specification. And maybe other regions in the world say, we need the concrete design specification. And that could be another module. And maybe we should completely rethink the process. Say, not just one document, and then we have all these workarounds of informative annex and notes and so on, what we learned in the last years. But we say, no, let's redesign it and make modules. And then we have modules for the user needs for the difference.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Anything else at the for the moment? Okay. Thank you for your openness for the discussion to contribute to that. We have here different opinions and different ways how we should proceed. And I think that's the great opportunity of this lab here, that we can discuss and finally have different ideas. And I'm open and ready to go back to the committee and propose some new ways how we can go on. Thank you very much for your contribution.
Thank you very much, Peter, and a very interesting presentation and vivid discussion already. And I've learned that while there are a lot of challenges to international collaboration, even beyond the cultural topic that we've been or that you've been discussing up front in your speech. Thank you very much, Peter. We'll just move on directly. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, and when I say move on directly, that's the second part of our session. That's the affiliate program, aiming to bring more countries into the international standardization community. We have evolving technical and economic developments and needs. So, ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to introduce to you now our next keynote speaker. It's Natalie Noah. She is secretary of Cameroon National Committee. And yes, there will be some thoughts that she's going to share with us about some potential add-ons on the program, on the affiliate program. Natalie, the floor is yours. And after your speech, we'll be following with a, hopefully again, vivid discussion with all of you here in the audience. Natalie, happy to have you here.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'm really happy to be here today, and my presentation comes after a really interesting presentation about the need of change of culture, and that is really important to understand the proposal from Cameroon. So this presentation has two objectives. The first one is to understand why it is so important to increase the involvement of developing countries in international standardization. And the second objective is to open our mind on opportunities to enhance the involvement of these countries in standardization, taking into account the need of a better balanced relationship between industrialized countries and less industrialized countries. Sorry. So my presentation will be in three parts. I will present the IEC affiliate country program. We spoke about that. I will show you, because everybody is not in this program or don't know exactly the content of this program. And then I will show the context and justification of our proposal, then the proposal. But in introduction, I would like to thank the DKA for this opportunity for a developing country to make some proposals on standardization, especially for our country, because the context and the culture is really different. We will propose some innovation. This innovation can be implemented radically or incrementally, depends on everybody. And I have to precise that the presentation is based on the case of Cameroon, not on the base of all the developing countries. We are not representing all the developing countries or all the African countries. It's just based on Cameroon. So what is Cameroon? You have to understand our context, the context where we were. Cameroon is a little country in the central of Africa. The capital is Yaoundé. The population, we have more than 25 million inhabitants. And we have two official languages, English and French. But I have to say I am more comfortable in French. Sorry for English speaker. But we have two official languages. But at the same time, we have more than 250 different local languages, because we have more than 250 different ethnics. So you can see that we have a lot of diversity, diversity of culture, diversity of ecosystem. If you go in the north of Cameroon, you will have a Sahelian savanna climate. You will have more than 50 degrees under the sun. And if you go in the south of the country, you will have tropical forest with 90% of humidity. So we have to face all this diversity. We are a middle-income country, which aims to become an emerging country by 2035. And actually, we are our mainly production are agriculture, from agriculture, forestry, hydrocarbon, sugar, oil, mining, etc. So you can observe that we produce essentially raw material. So if we want to become an emerging country, we have to industrialize our production, and that we need much more sources of energy. That is the main issues in our country. Actually, we depend on importation, as we import almost all manufactured products, as machinery, electrical equipment, transport equipment, fuel, even fuel and food, while we're producing the raw material for these products. So I told you that Cameroon is a middle-income country with a lot of diversity at geographic, at climatic and ethnologic level, which aims to become an emerging country by 2035. And this ambition needs, firstly, a speed economic growth, and secondly, institutional change and economic opening that will ensure a greater integration in world trade. And these are some agreements we signed that shows we are really open to this integration in world trade. We have signed, for example, the AGOA, the African Growth and Opportunity Act with the United States. And recently, we have just signed the economic partnership agreements with the European Union. So that creates a free trade between these two areas, between Cameroon and these areas. But we have to admit that it is in the benefits of industrialized countries as they have much more products to commercialize than us. We just have our raw materials, and they have all the manufacturers' products. So for the moment, it's not really interesting for us. Okay, and all our ambition has been elaborated. The objectives have been elaborated. There is a national document called Strategy Document for Growth and Employment, who fixed the target for every field, especially in electricity and electrotechnology. So we have everything. We have defined what we want, the vision, the objectives, and how to go them. But we are not able, actually, to implement it in reality. One of the reasons is the situation of the standardization in Cameroon. The ANOR is the national standards body. It was created in 2009 by the government. In fact, it was created by the President of the Republic. It was not a need from the private sector. It was not a need from the sectorial ministries. So you can understand that the main issue in Cameroon is that none of our stakeholders are involved in standardization because they see this NSB as a baby of the president. It's not something for them. It's not a tool to improve their competitivity. It's just something something bad for them. Annoying to them. Sorry for my bad English. One of the consequences is the low level of our standards. We just have 1,750 standards, and less than 3% concern electricity. That's really, really low. Why, for example, we import more than 1,000 different types of household appliances. So this is not enough. Our ambition is to have 8,000 standards in 2 years. So we know it will be really difficult as we don't have this involvement of our stakeholders. What about the electrotechnology activity in Cameroon? We have services really poor and products really poor. For example, in electricity, we have low voltage, intermittent cuts, billing errors. We have a lot of problem, daily problem. Maybe I can show you this picture. It was a joke forwarded by Facebook between all the Cameroonians, and it shows that you have different capitals in Africa. They have light. And Yaoundé, the capital of Cameroon, we are in dark. This is the current situation. So we have many problems. In telecommunication, more than 50% of telecommunication are always disrupted. And the market is dominated by counterfeit, which poor quality of electronic and electrical products. And we have many fires, for example, in markets. We have a lot of fires from electrical equipment. So that's really bad. And we have a lack of awareness of stakeholders, I just told you, lack of standards, I just showed you, and lack of controlling mechanisms and infrastructure as we don't have the requirements. So that was the context of Cameroon. So what about the IEC affiliate country program? So IEC family is composed by 169 countries. 84 are members, and 85, so more than members, are from in affiliate program. That we are more in affiliate than as member. It is a free program, so we don't pay any membership fee, but we don't have vote. We can assist to we have assistance to establish a national electrotechnical committee, and we have access to 200 IEC international standards free of charge in view of adoption at national level. And if we sell them, we have 90% discount. So that is really interesting for us. If we have adopted 50 national, international standards, and we prove that we have a NEC, we can become Affiliate Plus. Affiliate Plus give us the opportunity to adopt, not to see 400 IEC international standards, and we have the priority for IEC mentoring. Also, during general meetings, we have a forum and a NEC workshop. We can select about 10 technical fields and five experts from our countries can log in and access to comment on working documents, and we can ask for a technical mentoring for when we are Affiliate Plus. And we can attend to the meeting of TC and SC during the IEC general meetings. Last thing, we have the conformity assessment status. We can have e-learning modules. We can participate in regional workshop. We have webinars upon request. And we are observer in IEC conformity assessment system meetings. So it's really a good thing. This affiliate program is really a good thing for our country who are not so industrialized. These are the regional center. The IEC Regional Center for Africa has just inaugurated last year, and it was really a good thing. It is located in Nairobi. What about the Cameroonian NEC? The Cameroon joins the program of affiliate in 2005, and the NEC was created 7 years later. And we needed 3 years more to adopt our first standards from IEC. We adopt just 40 standards, so we are not Affiliate Plus. So we needed 10 years from the joining the program and the adoption of standards. So there is something, we thought that there is something we can improve. Our NEC is composed by all the type of stakeholders, thanks to the support of the affiliate program. So now we have public administration with all the ministries concerned, the government agency, the academic institution, the big companies, the main companies, and the consumers association. We are composed by almost 30 members. What is the context and justification? Industrial and commercial context. The first thing that is that at the WTO, more than 75% are developing countries. So they count. They are not nothing. The second thing is that they account for 43% of world merchandise trade in 2013. But African countries contribute just for 3%. That's really low. Why, for example, Asia contribute to more than 28%. That's really low. So there is something. At the same time, according to several international consultancies, Africa will represent the single biggest business opportunity by 2020. You can see here the GDP. African markets are starting from low base, but they are among the 10 fastest growing economies in the world. So I won't make a demonstration, but Africa is a huge opportunity for the world. It's there is a huge potential for the future. So we have to do something for them. Concerning the adoption of IEC international standards in Africa, I told you that 85 countries, the 85 countries in affiliate country program are developing countries, so they are more than members. And since the launch of the program in 2001, just 10 countries have become members of the IEC, including three African countries, Libya, Kenya, and Nigeria. That's not a lot in 15 years, sorry. And most of African countries who are affiliate needed about 5 years before adopting their first standards. Some countries need 8 years. So there is, I don't know if you can feel that, there is something we can do to improve that situation. Concerning the members, the members are 84 members, but just eight countries are from African countries and six from South American. But that means that just 15% of these two continents are member of IEC. And concerning affiliate country, we are about the half of member are from Africa. Let's go further. Concerning the affiliate country, I say in general the countries need 5 years, almost 5 years to make the first adoption. And in these 85 countries, 50% have not adopted IEC standards. So they are in the affiliate country. They have standards for free. They can attend technical committees for free, but they do not anything. They don't do anything. So there is a real margin of evolution in terms of adoption of standards and involvement of affiliated countries in international standardization. Everything is free, but they don't use it. So why this low involvement of developing countries? I don't have all the reasons, but these are some of the reasons that can explain this low involvement of developing countries in international standards. The lack of standards and quality culture, we just talked about that during the first presentation, by all the stakeholders in general, and especially by policymakers. The regulation sometimes is different, is in conflict with the standards, with international standards. So if the NEC or the technical committee want to work on the standards, immediately the government will say no, you don't have, because it is in conflict with our regulation. So it is it doesn't help the trade. Another reason, ineffective conformity assessment system for export and import product certification. That's logic. We don't have requirements, so how can we do conformity assessment for our product? The lack of awareness for all stakeholders, the lack of organization of the quality infrastructure. For example, in Cameroon, we import a lot of electronic and product from electricity, but we don't have any laboratory that is able to do analysis. So how can we know if a product is a good quality or not? We cannot. The low industrialization, I showed you, for example, in Cameroon, we produce mainly raw material. Emergencies related to the situation of insecurity or conflict resolution. For example, in Cameroon, in the north of Cameroon, we have some troubles with Boko Haram. I think some of you know that. So when we go to the Ministry of Economy, as we depend on government, to say this is the budget of NEC or this is the budget of the Technical Committee of Standardization, And we explain all the benefits of using standards, of making standards, of being in international standards. At the end of the conversation, the representative of the ministry say, okay, we have standards, we have your budget, but at the same time, I have death in the north of Cameroon, and if I don't finance military action, your standards will not be useful. So what is the best choice? You understand that, okay. Go your money, send your money to the north, okay. Use of different standards without adoption. We have a lot of big companies who are using, multinational companies who are using standards from their center, for example, from France or for Germany. And these standards are not adapted to Cameroon. But when you go to these big companies and explaining that we need to improve the structure of our standards body, they will say, no, I don't need it. I already have my standards from my company. So it's difficult. And the low speed of adoption. Now, why should we increase the developing countries' involvement? Why is it so important? The first reason is the consensual principle of standardization. Peter showed it during the first presentation. It is important. If you want standardization based on consensus, you need to have your users. Maybe we don't produce the products of the standards, but we use them, so we have to be at the table. Second reason, the highlighting of quality products against products of poor quality. I told you that in the Cameroonian market, we have a lot of counterfeit. It's because we don't know what is a good product. The better way to know is to be during the standardization making the work. The better adaptation of manufacture and export products. If you want to do a product for Cameroon, you need to take care of, for example, the diversity of climate. But if I don't tell you, how will you be able to produce the good product? And how will I be satisfied by your product? And the last reason is the WTO principle. Even if you just want to earn your money, there will be a point when you will realize if you want a sustainable business, you have to take into account of your partner in the trade. So you need to make an equitable and fair market. So now the Cameroonian proposal. Okay, I put this picture because we need a coffee to wake up, in fact, wake up Africa in international standard. Okay, the first proposal is the greater involvement of standardization in policymaking. That's true that standardization is based on voluntary, but in our countries, we need not to force, but we need to encourage the governments to be more involved in standardization. So we have three proposals here. Convince donors to insert a quality infrastructure development clause in the acquisition of contracts for cooperation funds. All of our governments get cooperation funds. So if we have a clause on quality infrastructure development, then the government will say, okay, it is important. So maybe we have to put some money, we have to develop the infrastructure, the quality infrastructure. So this is possible, this is possible. Second, setting up high-level outreach programs for policymakers in the affiliate countries that includes invitations to the IEC's general meeting. This is done, but not officially. We have to invite all the high level of our government to come here and to see how it is important. All the discussions are really important. We are building the future here. If you are not here at the table, your interests will not taken into account. encourage governments to mainstream standards in public procurement processes. That this is the best way to force the SMEs and the companies to use the standards. If you put it in public procurement, then they will use it. And this requires a dialogue with WTO, World Bank, AFDB, IMF, etc. IEC can do that. It's not complicated. They can do that, and I'm sure it will help us. Second proposal, it's a review of the affiliate country program. This program is really important, but maybe we can do some improvement. I hope my affiliate leader is agree with me. So the first proposal is to establish a progressive mechanism of free access to IEC's international standards based on effectiveness of NEC, as it is done actually, but also based on the evolution of the IEC standards used in the country. In Cameroon, I have adopted 40 standards, IEC standards, but I have sold none of them. Nobody is interested in these standards. So I think I have to make some promotion, to make some activities to promote and to show to IEC that we are using these standards, and then maybe I can have more free standards. So we have to do something. We have to improve the way we use these standards. Second one, creation of two statutes for affiliate countries. All country, we are not members, so it's not all member, it's all country, as actually we are attending 10 technical committee as observer. But another statutes, I proposed all country plus, granting access to 10 technical committees as observer, and also to one technical committee's working group as participant with no vote. I don't know how you say in English. Maybe you can help me to translate in English. In French, we say l'appétit vient en mangeant. When you taste it, then you want to stay and eat more and more and more. So if we attend to working group, to the work, their work, maybe it will help us to be more involved. Third one, establish an annual reporting mechanism in affiliate countries to their regional centers. Actually, we are members, we are affiliate in the affiliate country program, but we don't have to do anything. We just come once a year at the general meeting, and that's it. And during the whole year, we don't have to do any report. Did we do anything? Did the NEC have any meeting? We don't have. So we think that we need to make a report to the country, the regional centers, so they can assist us better. Establish of a virtual exchange platform between affiliate countries with frequent virtual meetings. If I have an issue, maybe the other affiliate country has a solution. So if we have these virtual exchanges, we can share our experiences, and it will help us to improve our process quickly. Implement an ownership program of IEC standards for NEC to get familiar with them. As I told you, I have actually 40 IEC standards adopted at national level, but nobody uses them because they don't know what is inside. And when I have the opportunity to get to see the 200 standards at affiliate country, I didn't have the opportunity to know what is inside the to understand the content of the standards. It's because I was not doing the work of standardization. So we need a program to help our stakeholders to get more familiar with the content of the standards, and an implementation of awareness program for stakeholders. We need your assistance to train our trainers to aware the stakeholders. The last proposal is a revision of the current pattern of affiliate countries' involvement and their access to membership of the IEC. Here we are thinking of the re-evaluation of the affiliate countries' membership fee based, as it is actually, on countries' socio-economic context, but also on the level of involvement of the next in international standardization, maybe during the first year, but it is to encourage them, if they have the motivation, they can become member more easily. And strengthening a technical sponsorship program for affiliate countries in technical committees. Actually, it exists, but we need more. We needed more. Finally, establish a discount based membership fee for members to persuade multinational companies, member of the NEXT with subsidiaries in affiliate countries, to get involved technically and financially. For example, we have Schneider Electric in different of our countries, so they have the capacity to be more involved in our NEC. They are involved in Europe. So if they are more involved in our country, maybe it will help all the other companies to be in the road. Thank you. So now the conclusion. Oh, I have this this picture. Okay, you have four people. The three people are trying to pulling the load with a square wheel, but they don't know that it's not the good solution. This is us. And you have another one proposing a round wheel, because he knows it would help them to go further and faster. But they say, no, thanks, we are busy. So this is exactly the situation. And we need you to give us more easily and to explain why this round wheel are more adapted. And this famous quote from Confucius, tell me and I will forget. Show me and I may remember. Involve me and I will understand. Thank you very much for your attention.
Natalie, thank you so much. That was a very interesting, deep view on your country, on your needs, and very vivid, in fact. And I really liked to see what your proposals on the furthering of the involvement are. So I think we have a very interesting discussion with you now ahead, and with on the topic will be on the affiliate program, and not only your proposals, but even more. We will open the discussion, and for that I now have the pleasure to ask on stage Dr. Bernhard Thies. He is the chairman of the board of directors of DKE German National Committee, and has been running the CENELEC, the European Organization's presidency, since 2016, the beginning of this year. Bernhard, the floor is yours, and I hope for a vivid discussion. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Natalie, for your nice presentation. Before I go to the audience to think, my first question is to you, what was your motivation to come here?
Oh, that's a big question. Do you have an hour so I can explain?
No, very short.
we believe that this is the future. We are really convinced that this is the future for our economy, for our country. And when we come here, we want to be visible. Yes, we count. We are not nothing, because oftenly industrialized countries say, okay, these African countries are not there, they are not interested. Or maybe we don't need their requirement, their interest. So we want to say we are here, we count. Thank you.
Okay, maybe some of you were a little bit surprised that we have an affiliate program in a reinvention lab on standardization. It's more shown, if you go to the outside, it's more shown on the technical point of view. And my question is, if you are talking about participating in standardization, do we need new technical tools, so it's easier for the developing countries to participate in standardization. Mm. Because I have always a feeling on standardization, we do it since 100 years. With paper we started, okay, then now we have electronics, we have emails, we have document server, and then we are working in the committee in the same way as we did it 100 years ago. And also, we have a document server, notification email you get there is a new document on the server. Please comment in 4 weeks. And you can download it, and you have Word file or PDF file or maybe other document format that is not on your computer. And then you have to make a comment on that. That is not efficient. And that is, I think, especially for the affiliate countries, really very inefficient way of working. Do you see that it's possible to get new kind of working together?
I'm sure we can. We have to think about it. But you're totally right. You had 100 years to build this system. And you saw that, for example, in Cameroon, we exist for 6 years. So in 6 years, we have to be at the same level than you after 100 years. So it's really difficult for us. And at the same time, our context, sometimes we don't have internet during a whole week. Sometimes we don't have energy. So it's difficult to be at the same level, to be able to discuss with you when we face all that kind of issues. So I'm sure we can think about new tools. I don't have the solution, but I'm sure there is something to do for that. Actually, I know that all the strategy, the IEC strategy and the ISO strategy is now we need the developing country. They have to be there at the table. So yes, we have to. We can do many things.
Okay. Now we'll go to the audience. Somebody who really is confirmed what Natalie said on the affiliate program?
Everything was clear. That's perfect.
Françoise.
Françoise Rauser, I'm the Executive Secretary of the Affiliate Country Programme. Thank you, Natalie, for this analysis, and that's very good points in your proposal. Just a little clarification. You say, and it's true, that they need clarification sometime on the text of the IC standards for adoption. But what I can see from other countries, they have a commenting rights on documents before it becomes a standard, and this is not used very much. I confirm what Natalie says, we need to help developing countries to use that right, and that's why we have launched this mentoring program, first to help them comfort the national committee, but specifically to help them participate at the technical level. So we need some technical mentors. What they use, maybe not Cameroon, but other countries, use a sort of right of questions, I would say, not a commenting right, but question rights. Mm-hmm. And when they adopt a standard, very often, because you're right, they were not at the table when the standards was developed, they have questions, but they use that right to ask the technical committee, what do you mean? We don't understand. I mean, I just think that Bhutan's done that several times, and other African countries have done that. And they ask me the question, obviously I can't answer, but I pass it on to the technical committee and they get their answers. So maybe that's something you could explore when you're at the adoption procedures to ask for clarification on the clause of the standards. This is something which is already working. Mm-hmm. But I agree, it's a little late at that stage and it would be good to have developing countries involved earlier at the CD, for example, because they have that commenting right that they're not using, and that's what we have to work to get them to get the feedback at that level, I think.
Yeah, I think also, thank you, François, that is the process behind to get very, very easily involved in standardization. I think that is what we need. We should use new technologies. And also, if you're in the morning session before here, for me, it's not a clash of culture. It's the advantage. So many different cultures in the world working together. And of course, we are 100 years, we know what the standard is, what really should be in. But if you come in as a newcomers, if you try to put these in a Word format or in a PDF format, mm-hmm. it's too thick. It's not readable at the end. And therefore, with the standard format, it's more data-based. And if it is data-based, then you can bring in a database very easy all the different requirements in the developing countries or in other countries, then it's in a document. And then you can tag all these parts of the documents. And then also for the companies which would like to bring products into that market, they can easily find out what are the requirements, especially in that country. That is also then for the developing countries. So if their companies want to sell their products, for example, to Europe, to understand what is the market entrance to Europe, what is the market entrance to China or India or elsewhere in the world. And if we start really now to find out a new way making standards in a document format, could it be a possible solution?
Okay. For example, during this general meeting, I have some experts from Cameroon who will attend to four technical committees. So I asked to Françoise some documents, the technical documents, so they can understand what is the content of the work. And for each technical committee, it gave me 2 hours to download the documents, 2 hours for one technical committee. So it, I was not motivated to continue to other technical committee. It takes a long time. Actually, we don't have really the problem for the exportation as we don't produce anything for the moment that in this field that we can sell. For the moment, we import. In fact, we import a lot. So, but as I showed you, we have an ambitious to become emerging. We have the ambition to industrialize. So, with this ambition, we will need it. So, actually, we have not thought about that. But I tell you, actually, it's not fading up, but it's not annoying, but when you have to take each day 2 hours just for one document, you say, okay, maybe it's not so important, maybe I can get without it, so.
Yeah, you are describing exactly what I feel. Mm-hmm. It's a problem, the technical solution.
Exactly.
Maybe you know the vision of DKE in the future of standardization. The vision is that we have a cloud, mm-hmm. and all the experts worldwide are making standards in a cloud. They are connected via tools like Wikipedia, like WhatsApp or other things, not using the tools, but the ideas about that. So it's very easy to be connected in the community. So you have not downloaded a document. You can directly do it in a totally different way, a very, very efficient way. Then, of course, the standardization organizations are also connected to this cloud, mm-hmm. and they have to orchestrate all these things, otherwise there is a chaos in the cloud. That is our thing we have to do. Mm-hmm. And at the end, the standard users are also connected to the cloud, and they take out of the cloud in the database format the parts of the standard which they use for their product, system, or services. And it takes years to implement that. If you look in this new area of making standardization, then it's much more easier for your experts to participate in standardization.
Maybe. I don't know. Maybe. Maybe another
African maybe some other, can, other can views from other affiliate countries.
My name is Haridas Sharma from Canada. I don't know very much about the affiliate program, but the presentation was great. It opened my eyes in terms of the needs of a developing country. And I also hear the other comment about the digital vision of DKE. But I, in my mind, in my simple mind, coming from India, and then now living through Canada, looking into diverse cultures and their needs, I believe we should not forget that human beings are not binary, okay? And those are the needs to be fulfilled at any cost, by any means, not necessarily by the binary means, okay? That's my point.
Okay, I fully support you, what you are saying. We need physical meetings. If you don't need each other, you have no the face for you, and then you make digital meetings, it will fail. So we need meetings as a General Assembly or some other meetings so the people know each other, know the face, know their behavior, know their culture, understand their culture, and that brings together, and that using digital tools for the future. Thank you for...
Maybe Peter was the right person to answer, but I just remembering that when we try to work by email in some technical committees in Cameroon, it didn't work a lot because at the end of the day, as you're saying, they need to face the people. They need to look into the eyes.
Exactly. Yes.
Are you the good person? Can I work with you? Yes. Can I exchange exactly. with you? Yes. So I don't know. I don't know what is the solution. Maybe it will work. Maybe not. We have to try. We have to try.
And also, as you said in the morning, confidence between the human beings. That is what we need. That is not really a clash. Maybe some other aspects from your side.
I keep thinking about something that my colleague said, Jens. It's about the content of the cloud.
Yes.
It's just not the tools for editing.
Yes.
We have to think in another way to put information, and to this database could help us to give our opinion and our needs. I completely agree with the lady from Cameroon that we are users of the standards. We need the standard to protect our people from the risk of electricity. Mm-hmm. And it would be great if we could give our input there as users. And something that Francois says, it's very difficult during the adoption. That is the first step to participate in the IEC work. To ask the committee. There is a direct way to do this. Yes, perhaps in this cloud could be some kind of tool to the developing countries to ask things about why those standards says or what does the requirements are for. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And you mentioned also in your speech in the morning, we say regulator, the government. And we know that we have in Europe, we have the European Commission, and they try to have the same regulation in all of the member states. And if you look to Africa, if you look at the landscape of Africa compared China, India, Europe, North America, put it into Africa, there's some space. Mm-hmm. It's a huge country there. And you mentioned that also the IEC should find out if a better discussion with the regulators. Do you have any idea how we can do that?
No, I don't have the solution. I'm here just to present, to make the presentation.
But maybe that some in the audience has an idea how we can get closer to the regulators. You know, in Europe, we have Senelec and IEC. We are working together with the European Commission. And now we find out a new way also around the whole globe, especially for Africa, because Africa is totally woken up. Francois?
I quite agree we need to involve the regulators, especially in Africa, but in all continents. And I think this is why we are helping AFIE country to establish their NEC. Mm-hmm. You have to have regulators in your NEC. and they have to have an active part. And as you know, we are going to have sometime a new affiliate leader because we rotate, and we could think of having maybe a regulator as an affiliate leader. What about that?
Yeah.
Instead of having a standardization body, you know, director, to involve really the regulators, that they realize what IEC can give, you know, and the standards can be used as basis for regulation, and they have to be part of the game. I think it's very important.
Well, I said I don't have the solution because, for example, in Cameroon, in the NEC, we have regulators. But what happens frequently is the director of the regulation company sends his secretary to the NEC because it doesn't understand what is the purpose of our work. So we do a lot of awareness program for ministries, for regulators, for the top management, but it's not easy because, as I told you, NSB and standardization for them is just a lobby from the president. It's not something really important for them. And when we were created, many ministries and regulator companies thought that we were trying to do their work. We were trying to make requirements, to make regulation then. And we have to explain that is totally different. We want just to help you. We give you the tool to help you in your work. So it's not the solution is not just to say you have to be in the NEC. It's how to make them understand that is really important for them, firstly for them, not for us. Yes.
We are in Germany facing the same situation. We
really?
Invited CEOs, managing directors from companies for talking about standardization. And who came? The expert from the company. So not the CEOs came. And then we also find a new way to address them, how important standardization is. Last question or remark from the audience? It's on.
See? I think this point is very important. How can support our work with regulators? In my country, for example, we have national priorities, not the standardization priorities, national priorities. We are looking for work together, private and government, in set up priorities. If regulators are in a line of these priorities, it's easy to work because the country wants to follow an objective. I think this is a key issue. So we need to work not alone, not only for NEC to involve the regulators. We need to have a contribution, an objective. I think this is the important things. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We're coming to an end. Please give a big applause.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie, again. And thank you, Bernard, also. And now, please stay here with me because I need your support because we have a final question to you, the audience. And we've been talking yesterday already, also during the opening celebration, about the general meeting app. And you've probably downloaded it and come across Paul's that also exists for different sessions, not only for the not only global polls that we have. So I would kindly ask you now to take out your smartphones and look at the at the main menu, and then navigate to the Reinvention Lab agenda, and then select the session we're in now, please. And in the horizontal menu, you see the tab polls. Select with Take the poll, the option that you want to answer. And once you've voted...
It's German, Befragung?
Yes. He has a German version on it, so there might be there might be not poll, but your country's language. So anyway, take the poll, and then in the end, very important, submit your response. So now we have one question prepared for you, which I'm going to read out to you now. And you probably see it on your iPhone already. The question is, what do you think could be useful for the IEC affiliate countries program in the future. And we have several options. It's new digital platform, it's the new membership fee structure, it's technical assistance projects, training to experts, or just very open other ideas. Natalie, what would you be your suggestion or answer on this?
This is really interesting. Maybe I should vote for other ideas because there is so many other ideas.
Okay. Bernard, you're just voting. What are you?
Did you vote for the other ideas for me?
No.
No?
Well, I see 8 votes, 9 votes. That we have some potential for improvement here. Still, have you voted already?
Yes, of course.
So what do you think is going to win?
The new digital.
Okay, the technical assistant could be the win. And also, I'm very, well, the first one, new digital platform to engage it.
Okay.
20%, I think next year they understood a little bit more what it does it mean, digital platform.
Okay, so okay.
I'm really good.
So.
Oh, no, it's 15%. Let's stop.
Don't change the results here. So, I look at the votes. Do we still get one more? Well, I think we have a picture that we can that we see. I think we see training to experts is important, the technical assistance part, and well, there's certainly a lot more ideas on the table. Natalie, you've brought up a lot today. And I think we've seen the great advantages, the privilege we have being an international community, but I've also seen the challenges ahead that we have to deal with within the next years. But I think, like discussed last night, actually in the opening ceremony, we have taken a first step now on discussing future needs and new innovative ideas that we can work with now to establish the IEC as the international community or organization or a global home for electrotechnical standardization. Thank you so much to the two of you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Natalie. Thank you, Bernard. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being our guests here in this session, and we will have the next session in just 45 minutes. That's at 11:15, and it's on transformation to agile standardization. So we'd be very happy to have you back here then, and until now, have a great coffee break, and thanks for attending. See you in 45 minutes.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.